那接下来的那个，我们进入今天上午的最后一个那个主题报告 ，Judea Pearl 的。那当然也是千呼万唤始出来了，刚才因为网络原因呢，各种各样的原因。那我们下面呢，有请智源研究院的学术顾问委员，美国加州大学洛杉矶分校的朱松纯教授呢，作为 Judea Pearl 报告的主持人，有请朱教授。
Hello，
我们听得见，可以了，可以了哈，这个首先祝贺这个智源大会的召开哈，今天非常荣幸来介绍一下我的同事也是一个非常值得尊重的学者，这个 Judea Pearl， Judea Pearl 呢，1936年出生在以色列，65年获得。 Brooklyn 的这个技术学院的 PhD， 他从1969年到现在呢，50年呢一直在计算机这个 UCLA 的计算机系和统计系任教。那么1994年的时候呢，因为加州系统出现了一个财务的情况，所以呢他们就提前退休了。那么然后呢他返聘回来做一些教课。那么我想。 这里面有一个很有意思的现象，就是说，Judea Pearl 的 career， 他的主要的一些被大家的所知是在他退休之后，那么好像我跟他刚才也开玩笑，他的 career 职业生涯是从退休之后开始的，那么包括了认知学会的一些认识，还有计算机协会的图灵奖以及最近到数学协会以及统计协会今年他说终于我们统计学会的人。 认可他了，认可他的工作，作为一个数学和统计的贡献。第二点呢，他的工作大概是分成三个时期，总结成为三本书。第一个时期呢，就是传统的以规则、逻辑规则推理的这种 AI， 他写了一本书叫做 Heuristics， 启发搜索。我最早找到他的时候，是因为我找不到这本书，我去问他。 哪里能找到这本书？他跟我说，我也是从这个旧货市场里面发现了这本书，他找到了一本，他自己在用。那么后来呢，到80年代的时候呢，他就意识到提前意识到了这个奇葩式和规则 AI 的一些局限性，他开始研究概率这个贝叶斯网络概率推理在认知科学里面做这个概率推理，写了一本书叫做。 1988年发表了这个，但是他做着做着的时候呢，他又意识到这个他的局限性非常大，所以呢，80年代的时候，他认为他是个贝叶斯的信徒，然后呢，到后期呢，他认为他只是半个贝叶斯的信徒，就是 half of Bayesian，OK， 因为他发现这个贝叶斯呢不能解决因果的问题，所以从1988年到现在啊，他一直在做这个关于因果的建模和推理。 那么近年来呢，他也在一直在关注哲学伦理这些社会上非常有争议的问题他喜欢这个争论的问题那么他的研究的特点呢，我总结成为两点，就是一个非常低维度的研究。有一次他在这个办公室跟我争论的时候，就是这次我跟他照了一张照片这个照片回过头来，这是我照的照片，他呢满墙都是奖，你看到没有，各个什么图灵奖什么这个奖那个奖。 然后呢，他的爱好就是去一些旧的书这本书，比如说这本书就是1850年的贝叶斯当时发表他当时那篇文章的时候那个期刊那一期是一个老书他前天在这些旧书里面翻，所以对计算机的话不是那么熟。那么他的特点呢就是低维度，我有一次跟他争论的时候，他说你看我只玩三个维度 XYZ， 顶多的话他来个 UVW。 他说：“如果我用3个变量说不清楚的事情的话，那你怎么可能用100个变量能够说得清楚呢？”所以我想今天的那个talk 里面，他主要还是用这么3到5个变量，不超过7个来说明他的问题。他终身的工作都是这么做。第二个呢，他是零数据，他不用数据。那么这一点呢很像爱因斯坦，就是说他不做实验，他就用思想实验。所以我想他是个思想的巨人。那么我想。 介绍到这一点哈，两个他的特点。那么下面呢，我就想让这个把这个 slide 给 Judea Pearl。那么我呢，他 他是在这个电话上进行连线，而我呢这个是给他翻这个翻页，好不好？来做这个翻页。Okay, Julia, so now it's your turn.
My turn now. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm speaking to you from Los Angeles, and I am very grateful for this refreshing introduction, which is the first time that I hear in Chinese. It's very refreshing to me, and I hope it's all authentic. I hope you see my first slide. I promise you
yes.
to talk about the new science of cause and effect. And the secondary title is the second data science revolution. When I talk about the second data science revolution, I owe you an explanation of what I mean by the first one. So let's click and go to the two data science revolution. Click. The first one has to do with the big data revolution, which we all heard about. And this is machine learning, neural networks, deep learning, applications, AlphaGo, voice recognition, machine translation, self-driving cars. It has been click in the limelight of the news media. And the characteristic of this revolution has been it is data-centric. Namely, its input is only strictly from the data itself. It is in the limelight. You have hundreds of university classes, and you have good jobs and good salaries. And I'm going to promise you now a second revolution. It is, I would call it the causal science revolution. Click, it's in yellow now, number two. And it has to do with the transition from data to policies, from data to explanation, to mechanisms, to generalizations, to assigning credit and blame, to talk about and define fairness, creativity, and blue sky, even free will. Click. The last bullet in purple says it is science-centric instead of data-centric. It is a silent revolution. You probably haven't heard about it in the New York Times. And I can promise you future jobs and future salaries, because I strongly believe that this is going to be the direction that data science is going to take in the next generation. Click, when I talk about the causal revolution, I have to support myself with someone else. I'm not the only one who coined the word the causal revolution. Here's a quote from Gary King, a professor of political science from Harvard. His quote is, "More has been learned about causal inference in the last few decades than the sum total of everything that had been learned about it in all prior recorded history." That's quite a sweeping remark by political science. And I can add to it my own quote. I'm a computer scientist, so I'm not that swift as a political scientist. To me, the revolution is summarized by the fact that we have hundreds of problems that were thought to be impossible and that can now be solved using simple mathematics and tractable algorithms. Click, I will go to the next slide. My outline will be to describe to you first what causal science is all about and why it requires a new logic and a new inference engine. Click the next bullet says, how would a robot acquire causal understanding? It's the structure of the new engine. Click the next bullet, ask us to imagine two fundamental laws. I call it the double helix of causal inference. If you know these two fundamental laws, you can derive everything by simple mathematics. You don't need me. You don't need to read anything that I have done. And that will be all part of your set of tools. Click to the new bullet. The next thing I'm going to describe to you will be seven tools of causal wisdom. The seven tools will be a collection of tricks, tools, algorithms of what we can do that we could not do before, and how they revolutionize science, and how they clarify cognitive, social, legal, and ethical questions. Now I'm coming to the slide called "What is causal science?" The first bullet is logic, explanation of what I mean by causal science. It's a logic and a set of tools for answering causal questions. And now it sounds circular, so I owe you explanation of what I mean by causal questions. The next slide gives you examples of causal questions. One, how effective is a given treatment in preventing a disease? Two, was it the new tax break that caused our sales to go up or our marketing campaign? Three, what is the annual healthcare cost attributed to obesity? Four, can hiring records prove an employer guilty of sex discrimination? Five, I am about to quit my job. Will I regret it? And look at the colors. I colored a few words there in yellow for a good reason, because this is the signal that tells me that I'm dealing here with causal questions as opposed to non-causal questions. I can tell them from 5 miles away. What's special about them is that they're unarticulable, look at the first bullet, in the standard grammar of science. You cannot describe them in the standard grammar of algebra that has dominated science throughout the ages. Why? Because all of them involve asymmetry. Science has been built upon algebra since the days of Galileo. For instance, if you say y is equal to ax, the equality sign is purely symmetric. You can write it x equal to y over a. If you see, if you say that the barometer reading indicates the atmospheric pressure tomorrow or today, then there's no way for a robot to tell the difference between the statement that the barometer, that the pressure determines the barometer reading, as opposed to the barometer reading determines the pressure. Equality sign is purely symmetric. But all of those yellow words that are colored yellow there have asymmetry there, preventing, cause, attributed to, discrimination, regretting. All of them involve asymmetry. It is the pressure, atmospheric pressure, that determines the reading of the barometer and not the other way around. The difference is an arrow. An assignment operator. For computer scientists, it is familiar operator in the study of the programming language. Nature looks at X, goes through some process, in this case multiplication by A, and assigns to a variable Y, a variable which is the output. output of that process. This is an asymmetrical operation, and everything that I'm going to talk about has to do with building a new algebra, the algebra of assignment, indicated by an error, and that error is the reason why we're using graphs. So what I have done in the past three decades, me and quite a few co-workers, is build an algebra for this asymmetrical connective called assignment. And the result of which I'm going to be happy to display to you. Okay? Now, let's go. Now that I explain what I mean by causal questions and why it is impossible to articulate them in the standard grammar of science involving equality science, I'm going to tell you what we can do with that new algebra. So I'm going to switch to the next slide, the title of which is What is Causal Science? The answer is, it's logic of tools of answering causal questions. Namely, it is an inference engine that has inputs and has outputs. Here are three inputs. What we wish to know, what we do already know, and what kind of data is available to us to do the task. Again, I colored with yellow the words which are very hard to articulate in the standard algebra. Your mentor, your professor, or your boss will be embarrassed if you ask him or her to articulate mathematically any one of the questions that we saw before. What we wish to know, if, for instance, whether a certain drug prevents a disease, to put it down, the word prevent, in algebra, in any formal language, it's impossible using the standard language of algebra. And these three inputs now can be articulated in the new algebra. What we wish to know, what we do already know, and what kind of data is available to now. Again, what we do already know involves knowledge about cause and effect relationship in the domain. And this is also something that is revolutionary to machine learning community, because here we need to rely on knowledge which is available to us and which is not articulable in terms of data only. So let me switch now to the two outputs. The two outputs will be one of two types, effect of pending interventions, and two, effect of undoing past events. Like, for instance, what if an earthquake did not take place? We go back in time and we undo event and we ask, how responsible are they for what we have seen? Like, I lost my house. It was due to an earthquake. If an earthquake did not occur, my house would still be intact. As an example. Now, I'm going to go to another slide, which is called a three-level hierarchy. It turns out that the question that we want to ask lies on a hierarchy, mathematical hierarchy, of three types of questions that are not easily mixed. They form hierarchy in the sense that to answer question in level I, you must have information from level I or higher. You cannot do it with information from level I or from level below I. For instance, if I want to find, look at level number two, intervention. If I want to find the effect of doing something, of intervening, I cannot do it by purely observational data from hand off, seeing, observing, from statistics only. I must go and get information either from experiments or from causal assumptions of interventional type. And let's look at the different layers one at a time. The lower level is all familiar to you. This is statistics, and if you want, also machine learning. That is why I put the owl and the robot on the first rung of the ladder. The owls and the eagles have formed a very good input-output relationship, which has an associational type. The owls can zoom in on a prey and predict the movement of the prey and catch the prey ahead of time. Same thing with the machine learning of today. Very, very good in learning specific tasks of associational type. Input, output. If I see something, I can tell you the probability of another event, why it ought to be believed in. Example, what does the symptom tell us about disease? What does the survey tell us about the election results? But when we go up the ladder to question of interventional type, what if I do something? What would Y be if I do X? If I take an aspirin, will my headache be cured? What if we ban cigarettes? Notice that we never banned cigarettes before, but we can still reason about the effect of doing it. How many cases of cancer we are going to save? What will be the black market from Canada in smuggling in cigarettes? We can reason about it. We can talk about it. We can speculate and we can scrutinize each other. This requires that we have a model of intervention. Higher learning has to do with counterfactual, also called imagining, retrospection, or understanding. What if I had done things differently? It also answers the question why. Was it X that caused Y? What if X had not occurred? What if I had acted differently? This is the nature of explanation. Was it the aspirin that stopped my headache? Or maybe it was the good news I got on the television. Would Kennedy be alive if Oswald had not killed him? What if I had not smoked the last 2 years? This is imagination, and I put on the ladder, I put Einstein, the jet age, imagination and computer age, a digital age. This is where we want to go. This is where innovation lies. This is what free will and automated science lies. I'll go now to the next slide because I want to impress you that this hierarchy is not due to my imagination. It comes from the mathematics. You can prove that you cannot solve the questions at level I unless you have information in level I or higher, but not lower. So here I'm going now to prove to you that you cannot deal with intervention from data alone. Look at this data, which is represented in the form of a scatter diagram. Every dot is an event or a person. And we describe here a collection of units, people, patients, describe how exercise increases the cholesterol level in this population of individuals. Every dot is individual. It seems like that when you exercise more, the cholesterol level goes up. It doesn't sound right because we are all conditioned to believe that cholesterol goes down when you the more you exercise. But you can explain it very easily by the following slide, which shows you that exercise is really helpful in every age group, but harmful to a typical person whose age you don't know. So you see, this cloud of individuals that we see on the right is composed by aggregating different age groups. This is known as the Simpson paradox, and it has been a perplexing paradox for 120 years. Both to philosophers and statisticians, it's still perplexing to most people who haven't learned causal science. But you see, there it's explained very nicely. The reasons that we have this paradox that it seems like exercise helps people is wrong. Exercise really reduces cholesterol in every age group. So it's only because we aggregate the data that we get this illusion that exercise can increase cholesterol. It's wrong. We have the knowledge to reason that way, but imagine that you have an algorithm that looks at that data. What question we want the algorithm to answer? I click now on the first question. Why not? Why is it impossible that the exercise will be helpful in every age group and be harmful to a typical person in the population? We find that it violates some basic rule of logic. What is it in our mind that makes us feel so offensive or so offended by this idea? Evidently, we have some logic in our mind that violates this possibility. Next question we want to ask, and I click, is exercise helpful or not? Well, we all say, yes, it is helpful because it is helpful for every age group. Why? Why is the specific data more helpful than the combined data? We ask, is it because it's more specific? I click here on the more specific. If we go by the rules, the more specific is the correct one, we get into a contradiction. And I'm going to show you the contradiction in the next slide. It tells you how data specificity goes wrong. Imagine two stories. One is about a drug and gender and death. Bad for men, bad for women, and bad for people. That is wrong. That is correct. If it's bad for men and bad for women, it must be bad for people, right? Because we go into the more specific, and men and women is more specific than just people. Now, let's use the same data, but change the story. The story will be about the 19th century discovery that more people die from a vaccine than they die from the smallpox. And people protested and asked the government to ban vaccine, which was wrong, because vaccine is good for the population because it eradicates smallpox. So here we have bad for smallpox, the people who developed smallpox, bad for people who did not develop smallpox. If we go by specificity, we should conclude that it's bad for people, but it's wrong. So we crisscross it and we reason not by specificity, by some other rules. What is that other rule? Who supplies us the information to go from the top graph to the lower graph and say, no, specificity doesn't count. Specificity goes wrong. We need to reason causally. The answer lies in the causal story. And not if two, and this, by the way, the same data would fit both stories. The two stories are statistically equivalent. They could not be told apart. And therefore, if information changes from the story, if the conclusion stands with the story, it must be that the causal story is the source of the information and not the data. So this is the proof for you that data itself is insufficient to evaluate actions. No data in the world can tell you what action is, whether action is good or bad. You need to have the story behind the data, and that's what we mean by causal assumption. Once we understand that this problem, and once we resign to the idea that we must supplement the data with causal knowledge, we have to ask ourselves, how do we articulate that causal knowledge? And I'm going to go forward now. I'm going to go to the next slide. Oh, one more thing. Just to promise you that the calculus that has been developed thus far answer those questions algorithmically and reliably. It gets us the correct answer. And how do we know that it is the correct answer? First, by mathematical. Second, you can do simulation. It's mathematically correct. I'll go to the next slide now and talk about the secret of causal reasoning. The secret lies in distinguishing seeing from doing. Look at this example. You wake up in the morning, you find that the pavement is slippery, and you ask questions. You can ask, for instance, what if we see the sprinkler on? Can we tell something about your rain? Look at the difference between this question and the question, what if we turn the sprinkler on? From turning the sprinkler on, I could not tell whether it's rain or not. But from seeing the sprinkler on, I could reason about the season, I could reason backward, and I could reason about the rain. The difference lies that if I do sprinkler on, I subject the event, sprinkler on, to the power of my muscle, and I disconnect it, I dislodge it from the influence of season, and I disconnect the arc from X1 to X3. I call it a surgery. And I have a new graph. I have a new belief system. I have a new world. And everything that follows from this surgery mutilated new world. I can also ask counterfactual questions. For instance, what if the sprinkler were on? Now we have to reason backwards. Having seen the slippery pavement, I can reason backward and say, what is the likelihood of season being on, rain being on, under the influence of my surgery, had the sprinkler been on? Okay, we understand. And now we come to the first two fundamental laws of causal inference. First fundamental law. It's the law of counterfactual and intervention. It tells you how to compute the counterfactual from the causal description, from causal model of the world. Here is a graph which gives you the causal model of the world. Each variable is simply a function of its parent. You see, W3 is a function of X. X is a function of Z3 and W1. There's no secret about it. Very simple function. To compute the counterfactual, all you need to do is to mutilate this picture of the world, cut off the arrow that goes into Mr. X, the variable X, execute a mutilation, and form a new model, and simply solve for Y in the new model. It's just a solution of equations, and every high school student knows how to solve equations. It is embarrassingly simple. Counterfactuals are embarrassingly simple, computed by solving equation of mutilated model. That's all there is to counterfactuals. Once we know how to compute counterfactuals, we can compute intervention, and we can solve most of the problems that we need in causal algebra. Next, the second law is conditional independence. The separation that you see in the graph tells you about conditional independences in the data. So So you have means now of overruling, of testing your model and seeing whether it is compatible with the data. I will demonstrate it here in the following few slides, reading in dependency. Every time you see a missing arrow in the graph, it dictates, it imposes a conditional independence condition with constraints on the data. For instance, here, you find that the missing arrow between C and W, but by the way, the graph stands for a collection of functions, although we don't have to specify the function, but we imagine their existence. So no matter what the functions are, and no matter what the distributions of the arrows, U, C, U, S, and so on, if you have a missing arrow in the graph, you can guarantee that the data should show you a conditional independence given by the two separated variables, C and W, separated by the set S and R, which we separate the all the paths going from C to W. And the same thing with a little twist for colliders. I'll skip over that. I'll talk about the applications. This allows you to do model testing. Because if you find incompatibility with the data, you know that your model is wrong. You can do more. You can do structural learning. You can do you can reduce scientific question to symbolic calculus. And this is what I'm going to show you on the next slide. The next title clip is the 7 tools of causal science. This is the outcome of the algebra. This is what you can do. One, encode causal assumption in transparent and testable way. We talked about it already. Two, predict the effect of actions and policy. And I'm going to demonstrate it a simple example soon. Tool number three is computing counterfactuals and finding causes of effect. Not only effect of causes, but causes of effect. So you can talk about attribution, assign credit and blame. You can talk about explanation. You can talk about susceptibility. How susceptible is a customer to a certain advertisement, or how susceptible is a certain patient to a given treatment, and so on. Tool number four, distinguishing direct from indirect effects or mediation, which allows you to answer questions about job discrimination, about inequality, about fairness. There's no way to talk about fairness in machine learning, fairness in AI, without an understanding of mediation. And mediation calls for counterfactual reasoning. There's no way to define indirect effect except by counterfactual logic. Tool number five, integrating data from diverse sources. I will demonstrate it. And tool number six, recovering from missing data. Tool seven, causal discovery. And I'll demonstrate each one of those in one or two examples. Tool number one and two together, I will demonstrate by looking at a simple example given by Schreier and Platt. What is the effect of warm-up on injury? It has to do with sport medicine. It's still a question which is debated in the circle, whether warm-up helps or makes the injuries more likely. Well, here is a perception of how a scientist imagine what could be a factor that affects the injury after a warm-up exercise. And you can see some of those are very hard to measure. And the question is, what should I measure? Each measurement is costly. It may even be impossible. Should I measure all of them, or is it enough to measure just a few? Well, the calculus takes this example. This graph is a description of what you know. It's qualitative. It doesn't involve any numbers. It's purely qualitative. Which are the factors which directly affect each variable. Look at every variable, it has a parent, and that is all one needs to specify. The next is ask the question of what I want to know. You want to know what to measure. Here's the answer. Bing! If you measure these two, Z1 and Z2, or Z1 and Z3, it's enough for you. You can identify the effect of warm-up on injury. It also tells you, no, don't measure previous injury. Because if you do that, you're going to get into bias. It's called selection bias or collider bias. No. That is the kind of answers you get from the do calculus. Okay? I've just demonstrated the two first tools, expressing what you do know and expressing what you want to know. Next, tool number three, algorithmicized counterfactuals. Task, I give you a model, I give you data. Determine what your salary would be had he had one more year of education. So we are talking here about a specific individual, Mr. Joe, not about the population, about Mr. Joe. He currently has a salary of X number of dollars per year, but he stayed in school only 3 years. What if he had stayed 3 years? What can we say about Mr. Joe? That is the kind of question you must have counterfactuals, because you are dealing with a specific individual. So you are dealing with the question of, can we go from group data into individual behavior? And the answer is yes. The probability of every counterfactual can be computed or bounded using the surgery procedure that I described to you earlier. And the corollary is that we can talk about causes of effect, we can talk about attributing credit and blame, in this case to the schooling, and it can be formalized. Here's an example, attribution, a court case. Your Honor, my client, Mr. A, died because he used this drug. So here's the lawyer for the deceased trying to ask for compensation. And the court must decide whether it is more probable than not that Mr. A would be alive but for the drug. This is how compensation is decided in the court of law. It's not my invention. That's how the court decides whether the defendant is liable for damage or not. Whether it is more probable than not that the action would not, that the result would not have taken place but for the action of the defendant. Well, you see this criterion, it has to be formalized mathematically, and we have a name for that, probability of necessity. Look how we formalize it in the language of counterfactual. Look at the bullet, it's called PN. The person is dead. He took the drug. So we put these two events behind the conditioning sign in yellow. Then we go and we put the counterfactual. He would be alive had he not taken the drug, and the no drugs go into the subscript. It is a counterfactual. It has this probability must be greater than 50%. That's how we mathematically formalize the cost qualitative this criterion for attribution. The answer was surprisingly could be, sometimes be very informative, and you can get the probability of necessity to be one out of a combination of group data, experimental, and observational data. It is surprising, but it shows up in the numbers. And this is something which is extremely useful, to take a combination of experimental and observational data that gives you more than each one individually and reduces the bounds on probability of individual behavior. I go now to the next issue, which is, well, which is, it's part of this assignment of inferring individual behavior. Now, with the corona outbreak, we have been bombarded with information and bombardment with the need to identify patients in need. It's again, it's a counterfactual notion. You cannot talk about patients in need unless you talk about how susceptible patients are to treatment, and this is a counterfactual notion. Next click. It is captured by a counterfactual measure called PNS, probability of necessary and sufficient, PNS. It's a probability that a patient with characteristic C will improve if and only if treated. That's how we write it mathematically. And it can be, again, be bound and get an informative bound from a combination of observational and experimental data, not from each one alone. Going from group data, that's my conclusion now, the last bullet. Going from group data to individual behavior requires counterfactual logic. You cannot do it from interventional experiment only. You cannot do it from associational data alone. I go to the next tool, mediation analysis. That's dealing with direct and indirect effects. The task is giving the data and a model, unveil and quantify the mechanism that transmits changes from causes to its effect. And the graphical representation of counterfactual tell us when direct and indirect effects are estimable from data, and if so, how necessary or sufficient the mediation is for the effect. And these are two independent measures, how necessary it is and how sufficient mediation is for the effect. What can we do with that? Well, it has a tremendous legal implication. For instance, deciding whether an employer is guilty of hiring discrimination. If we have a gender and men are more qualified for the job than women, we don't blame the employer, we blame society. So we ask really for the direct effect of X and Y. This is what the employer is responsible. A discriminating employer has a direct effect, and that is what is punishable by law, not the indirect effect. Therefore, we ask for the direct effect. How do we define direct effect? A standard way would be to adjust for M, but that's wrong because you might have here a collider at M. So the idea is not to adjust, but to go counterfactually. And this is a definition, counterfactual definition of discrimination. This is the qualitative definition by court of law. That's how the court defines discrimination. Look, it has a nested counterfactual here. Whether employer would have taken the same action had the employee been of different race, age, ex, religion, national origin, etc., etc., and everything else had been the same. This is how lawyers talk. Our job is to translate into a formal language, and this is how it is formulated. Okay? Natural direct effect of X to Y is the expected change in Y, in this case hiring, when we change X from X0 to X1 for each unit in the population, and we keep M constant at whatever value it attained before the change. We can write it in a simple counterfactual form here, and we are done. Because once we have a formula for the things, we can reason about it. We can ask, can we estimate it? What, under what condition can we estimate it? What kind of data is necessary to make it estimable, and so on. So this leap from qualitative talking about the court and with double counterfactual to a formal language is what the causal science gives you. And we are now in a position where we can solve for such queries. So we can talk about fairness and we can talk about discrimination and so on. Next slide, tool number 5, generalizability or data fusion. The problem is how to combine results from several experimental and observational studies, each conducted on a different population and under a different set of conditions, and we need to infer the behavior of a population in totally different environments, so as to construct a valid estimate of effect size in yet a new population unmatched by any of those studies. That happens again and again in the outbreak of corona. We got information from China, we got information from Spain, we got information from Italy, and we had to put it all together and come up with an action of what to do in United States, of what to do in whatever, in California, and so on. And it hasn't been used, although the technique is available. So this is how I envision the problem in real life. You have a target population, say the behavior of people in Arkansas. And I chose Arkansas because I never been there. And we have information coming from New York and Los Angeles. I click on another, we have information from Boston. Each one is characterized by different populations. Look, in Los Angeles, we have younger population. In Texas, we have mostly Spanish subjects and high attrition rate. San Francisco, people complain about blood pressure and so on. We have to put it all together and come out with an opinion or with a conclusion about the causal effect in the unseen population of Arkansas. It's undoable when you talk about it informally, and this is the way things are done today, informally. You have to reduce it to mathematics, and the mathematics is available. I click on the next slide. Here it is in the mathematics. The problem is each population is characterized by a graph. The differences among the population and in the conditions under which data is taken is signified here by the yellow arrow. You see the yellow arrow going down saying F. These are suspected factors that make one population different than another. Once you put them in a graph like that, you have the mathematics to take them all, combine them, and come out with a conclusion about the target population in purple here that you haven't even seen. All you know about it is how it's different from the other population. So it's a qualitative knowledge. You have to know where you suspect the difference to exist. Once you know that qualitatively, you put it into mathematics and you come up with a mathematical conclusion. I go now to the next tool number 6, missing data. Every data is corrupted by missingness. And determining what relationships are responsible is a causal question. We have to come up with a resolution of what would the data been like as if no data were missing. This is a counterfactual question, and it's reducible to a study, to an exercise in causal reasoning again. Same mathematics. The result is graphical criterion. Unveil when estimability is possible and when it is not and how. Statistic itself is insufficient. Missing data is a causal problem. And I explain to you why. Because it relies on knowing the reason for missingness. I go now to tool number 7, do with causal discovery, and this is an attempt to infer the causal graph from data only, based on some mild assumption. Under certain circumstances, this is the result, and under certain weak assumptions, called faithfulness, causal queries can be estimated directly from the compatible set of more of graphs that is compatible with the data, and then we can represent them compactly and ask questions about the set. And this work has been done primarily in CMU, recently in Germany by Peters et al. And I wouldn't elaborate on that. It's in the literature. It is picking up momentum lately. I have finished tool number 7, and I'm ready now to give you the conclusion. The conclusion will be in the form of a statement and a prediction. The causal revolution is spilling over from research to education and to application. It's shifting data science from its current focus on data to its intended focus on science. The peak of this revolution is still ahead of us, and I can predict that in the next generation, we are going to see a major revolution, primarily in social intelligence, which means that we are going to have an intimate and meaningful conversation with the machine. The machine will be able to model the user, to model the belief system of a user, whether the user is adversary or a partner or another machine, and deal and communicate with that partner in the way we deal with our partners. Convincing, swaying, and outsmarting. All this will be part of the social intelligence that I predict will take place in the next decade. And the blue sky will be free will and ethics, which I write is the compassion here. Eventually, we are going to have computers which will exhibit behavior as if they have free will, autonomy, and compassion and ethics. But let's leave the blue sky and focus on the next generation, which will be social intelligence. I thank you for being attentive listeners. All this I want to credit joint work with my previous students, my collaborators, and my co-authors, and my reviewers. And I'll go to a short commercial, and I'm happy to show you here a cover of my book of Y in Chinese. You're all welcome to enjoy it. And I hope you'll be part of the causal revolution. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Judah. Congratulations, and we made it after all the tries.
Was it hard to follow?
It worked. Okay. So for the host, do you have a time for a couple questions?
Yeah, of course. I think we have 2 questions, maybe something like that.
Yes. Okay, so Julia, I really like the idea of concept of from data to science. Okay, so we shift the focus from data to science. Instead of just looking at the probability and the statistics model, now we're to causality. So my obviously there was a question before. I think you already answered. They say, for the next decade, what do you predict will be the most important development? I believe you already answered that.
I partly answered that. Part was the 7 tools that I described here. Being able to generalize data to go from cause, from effect to causes, to talk about attribution, to talk to recover from missing data. All these are ideas that have been solved on paper now. We have the mathematics and we have the tools in the form of algorithms. We need to train individuals to implement them in specific domains. And that is what I believe will be the next revolution, to train hundreds and hundreds of PhDs that would be able to outsmart their mentors. Because this revolution is more than just technology transfer. It is highly traumatic for machine learning people to agree that you need to have domain-specific knowledge and you have to have a special language to express those domain-specific knowledge. It isn't enough just to look at data. It's highly traumatic for them, and it takes a paradigm shift, and we need to go through that transition. It's a paradigm shift. That's one. And the second area where I think we are going to see a major, major breakthrough will be in the social intelligence. Our machine should be able to model the user and talk to the user as we talk to each other. That is, I believe, is going to be a revolution, because we haven't seen it yet. So there will be explanation produced by machine, the way you produce explanation to me, and the way I try to convince you to change your mind. This is going to happen in the next decade. I'm definitely sure about it.
Yes. Okay. I have a different way of interpreting the idea. So I used to say, when you move from statistics, it's more of a regression, and then you go to simulation, right? The two equations that you have, y equal to ax, that's regression, that's all statistics about. Then you go to a simulation, which is, you can imagine prediction, you know, regret. So my argument is that a thing exists, that's a physics model. So is that fair to say we are moving from statistics modeling to physics modeling, a physics mentality of understanding the data?
It's a very accurate description, and I agree with it. I have two comments on that. The calculus of causation that I have described here saves you from doing simulations. I do the simulation by equation. I don't need the simulation. I don't have to write it, because I can get a closed form formula for the result of the simulation. The formula that I get from the Duke calculus tells me not only what the answer is going to be, it tells me what the answer is going to be when the number of samples go to infinity. And I can then test by looking at the formula, what are the crucial elements of my model that will make the conclusion change? I don't have to re-simulate it. It's all in the formula. It's the same thing as getting a closed form solution in algebra, or getting it by simulation. But I agree with you. Conceptually, it's just doing simulation using a data generating model. The error there is just an assignment, and this is just a data generating model which allows you to simulate samples after samples. The causal calculus is nothing else but a shortcut that gives you a closed form solution to the simulation exercise.
Yes.
Also notice, we don't have to assume the functions. When you do simulation, you have to assume the form of the functions of between any two variables. And you have to assume statistics on the error term. Yeah, in our case, we just have the graph. It's all quantitative.
So yes. Okay.
The calculus tells you how much, what kind of knowledge you must have before you can draw the conclusion that you're interested in. Some conclusions do not require specification of the functional relationship. They require only qualitative. Who is the father of whom? Other queries do require. The calculus tells you what kind of data and what kind of specification is needed. And it gives a guarantee. You cannot do better. You must have that. All this comes from the calculus. But it's a good question.
Okay. Thank you. And I have one challenge, you know, that I usually ask you is that if you look at the physics, they studied many types of physics at many space-time scales. You have a larger scale, you have a social phenomenon like a smoke cancer, right? But then you have a smoke cancer is causality. It should go to a biological level, which is you indeed need to see the causal effect in a chemical level. So that means, are you expecting we also have those kind of a multi-scale, you know, causal and data analysis and disciplines like physics?
I do not exactly understand what you mean by multi-scale. Whether we have
multi-scale means a phenomenon explained in multiple, you know, you know, like a physics, right? You have larger scale physics, and then you have a quantum mechanics physics. You know, they have different scales, like a statistical physics.
Yes. I haven't dealt with it. I imagine it should come into play, but I haven't personally done any multi-scale analysis. It will be very interesting to explore.
All right. I think thank you, and we learn a lot. And I hope you're gonna have a you know relaxed evening after all the you know drama. And so, host, are we in time now to conclude?
Yeah. Thank you, Judy. So thank you very much. Actually, there are more than 200,000 users, online users watching your talk. So thank you very much for the excellent talk. And also, 感谢那个朱松纯教授的介绍，还有 Judea Pearl 的精彩报告。那我们今天上午的开幕式的环节呢，就告一段落。下午我们还将有人工智能的数理基础、智能体系结构、芯片，还有这个 AI。科技论坛、女性论坛的三个专题论坛，那以及还有晚上我们有一些特色活动，包括 AI 对战的星际争霸职业选手挑战赛，还有这个晚上有两场这个尖峰对话，一个是 AI 精度与隐私的博弈，还有一个 AI The Past and the Coming Decade， 欢迎各位继续关注，感谢大家。